Rev up your engine!
Hey, it looks like Toyota's really coming back with all their old cars. They did that Supra, even though it's actually a BMW Roadster. Now they're talking about bringing back the MR2, and they say it's going to come back as either an electric model or a hybrid model. The starting price around $45,000. I mean, it's still kind of up in the air, but I guess that's mainly going to be dependent upon if the Supras sell, if they sell a whole bunch of those, if they sell enough of them, who knows, maybe they'll bring the Celica back as some kind of crazy thing too. It's just a name, you know? I mean, if they're going to bring back the MR2 and it's an electric vehicle, well, it's a different vehicle. They're just going by a name. So our whole society's gone name bonkers anyways, if you ask me. People, I got to buy this Nike shoe, I got to buy this or that. They're just taking a name and they're putting on like the Jeep Renegade. It's a Fiat, and they just took the name Jeep Renegade and modified a four-wheel drive Fiat called the Jeep Renegade. I mean, a lot of these times, names don't mean that much anymore anyways. Landmark 1212 says, hey, Scotty, what's the latest model car I can buy that can't be hacked? If you get any car that has an actual key that you turn, you can't really hack into them. If it's got a key and it has an immobilizer chip inside the key, not these keyless ignition systems, but an actual key, it has an immobilizer like a Toyota, you can't hack into them because you got the actual key that has to be cut to fit in and the immobilizer chip. The problem with the keyless ignition systems are there's no key to turn. It's just taking a signal from your keyless remote and starting a car. And any mechanic, myself included, could go to eBay and I could say, buy a keyless remote for like $40 for a Lexus. And with the equipment that I have, these fancy machines, I could, if I can get into the car, if it's unlocked or break into it, whatever, I could hook my computer up and then say, add this key as the new key, and it will, and then I could steal the car. I don't steal cars, so, you know, that's not my game. But anybody who wants to can. But if it's got an actual cut key, no. Because the key has to be cut to fit in the ignition and turn. That'd be the kind of car you want. There's still quite a few of them out there that don't have this stupid keyless remote stuff. Giglio says, I got a 96 F-155 liter. It clicks once, only once when you try to start it. It's not the battery. It replaced the starter solenoid, and now that's not it either. Do you know what it could be? Okay, let's pray it's not what I think it might be. It could be your engine's locked up. Turn the key. Power goes to the starter. Then the starter engages to the flywheel and turns. If the only thing you hear is a click, that means the starter gear is clicking. It's moving into the flywheel, but the motor isn't turning. Pray it's the bad starter itself, not the solenoid, but the actual starter motor, or it doesn't have enough power. Run power directly from the battery to the starter with jumper cables and pray it works. Because if it doesn't work then, your engine's locked up. And for that, you get a long extension bar and a socket that goes on the front of the bottom of the crankshaft and try to spin the engine. If you can't turn it by hand, the engine's locked up. And that's often what does it. Pray it's just the whole starter itself that's bad though, or the wiring, and not that your engine is locked up. Immortal says, thoughts on a Nissan Xterra, Scotty? They can be decent vehicles. I've had customers buy them. They were happy with them. Drove them over 100,000 miles, pretty much trouble-free. But I've had customers that kept them too long. 150,000, 160,000. They fell apart. Engines burn out, transmissions burn out. And never, ever buy a used one that's got more than 100,000 miles in it, unless you're getting it cheap, like for $1,000 or something. What the heck? If it lasts for a while, yeah, you get your money's worth out of it. But they're not something that's going to last and last and last. But if you want something and you get it super cheap and you're planning on only driving it 100,000 miles, yeah, you could be happy with it. Kinetis says, thoughts on a 1990 Nissan 300ZX naturally aspirated automatic. All right. In the day, those were excellent sports cars. People love those things. But now, it's a 1990. So what are we talking about? We're talking about a 30-year-old car. That's 30-year-old. That is old. If you're talking about buying one, if you can get it cheap and use it for a weekend toy, hey, have fun with the thing. But don't buy a car like that and think that you can drive it every day as an everyday driver and put 15, 20,000 miles on it because it'll fall apart in front of your very eyes. 30-year-old cars, all the rubber's going to rot. All the electronics going to start cracking and wires will start shorting out. So if you want a toy and it's cheap, sure, go ahead. But don't think you can drive that every day. Video 4500 of a Chevy Cobalt. The transmission shifts only when it's hot poorly. Those are terrible cars as they age. They have horrible transmissions. Yours is wearing out. When a transmission gets hot and it starts shifting poorly, it means that there's stuff that's worn inside. Now, if you were really lucky, it could be something like a shift solenoid gone bad. You could have a mechanic check it with this fancy scan tool. But from my experience with those, if they shift fine when they're cold, but then when they heat up, they start shifting hard, it's the transmission's going out. As it heats up, the metal expands, things are worn, and they don't shift right. I would never buy one of those cars, but you have it, so try to take care of it. But I wouldn't say rebuild it if it did need to be rebuilt, because the car's generally not worth it. I would just drive it until it doesn't shift anymore, then junk it. So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.